Hi everyone, this is Brian Hayes and welcome to episode 3 of the Music Mind podcast. Today I'm delighted to bring to you the wonderful talents of Andrew 𝗖𝗼𝘂𝗿𝘁𝗲𝘀𝘀. Andrew has been a professional musician since before he left school, working in Singapore, Hong Kong, Italy, and for the last 20 years here in Australia. Andrew has a reputation as one of our finest ever saxophone and flute players, and he's also a keen electronics man, dabbling in the electronic wind instruments from the early days, and nowadays focusing on the Roland Aerophone version of the EWI. I strongly recommend that you check out Andrew's website, andrewohmusic.com.au. That's A-N-D-R-E-W-O-H music.com.au. I'm really delighted to bring you my conversation with the great Andrew 𝗖𝗼𝘂𝗿𝘁𝗲𝘀𝘀. Well, hi, Andrew, and welcome to the Music Mind podcast. It's a genuine thrill to have you as my third guest in this podcast series.
Thank you, Brian. Nice to connect.
Yeah, it's really great. And we've
good
just
to
had
see
a,
you.
Yeah, it's great to see you too, Andrew. We've just heard an extract from the title track of this album, Silk, with a fantastic tenor sax sound, a gorgeous, fat tenor sax sound.
Thank you.
A song that, looking at the liner notes, that you wrote yourself, just sole, no other collaboration. Is that right with that track?
No, not with
Silk. So it was.
I did about 3 or 4 songs myself on that album.
And Silk is one of those or not?
Yes.
Yes.
So
that's where I'd like to start a question, because I'm aware of you as a saxophone player and a flute player, fantastic flute and sax player, and also the Roland equivalent of the electronic wind instrument. But do you play
That's
a
right.
chordal instrument?
Only for writing.
So keyboards or whatever.
Just play keyboards for writing.
Okay, because that's I was going to ask you. I mean, like Silk is not a 12-bar blues. It's not the standard G, C, and D.
No.
So I was just a little intrigued. So obviously when you composed that, did you on the keyboard?
On the keyboard.
Yeah, and yeah.
Yes.
It's a great song, and the sound on the tenor
was
recorded, I think, in 2003. And the sound on that tenor, I'm a saxophone player myself amongst a million other instruments, but that sound,
yes,
your sound on the tenor there is, in my opinion, without feathering your nest, you know, one of the top 5 best tenor sounds I've heard in that style. It's really great.
Oh, thank you. Thank you very much.
It's
yeah.
Really, it's really great. And
I tried to, sound has always been a big thing for me.
Yes.
And I'm not one that would change mouthpieces and reeds. I stick to one that I like and work on it.
Yeah.
If you know what I mean.
Well, look, this is a really interesting point because our listeners are people interested in the creative life. Many of them are musicians and quite a few, no doubt, will be saxophone players. So how would you say, like, you've got a very personal sound on the saxophone. It is your sound.
Yes.
Thinking back, how do you think you've developed it? What did you do? And I know it's an ongoing, it's a lifetime thing, but how would you, if you were advising a young tenor player or whatever, to get their own sound, what's some of the advice you'd give?
Sound is a perception in which what you hear in, first of all, you have to have an idea of the sound that you like. For example, when I was starting out as a young musician, I would be influenced by a handful of players that I liked the sound of. I started out with Junior Walker, King Curtis, you know, Maceo Parker, all the soul players.
Yes.
And then I got into Wilton Feldman of the Crusaders.
Yep.
People like Grover Washington. And I would imagine the sound that I like and then try to develop it by choosing the right mouthpiece and reed that would help me attain the sound. And I would play along with these recordings to copy it. It's just mimicking the sound. Yeah. And that got me to develop my own sound through mimicking a handful of players that I like.
That's great advice.
And that's how I developed the sound.
That's great advice.
I think a lot of players do that anyway.
Well, I think a lot of players... What I was going to say there, Andrew, is a lot of students, when I ask them, who's your favourite sax player, they come around for a sax lesson and they'll just stare at you. They can't name any favourite sax player.
Yeah, that's right.
And to me, that's where you've got to start to build some sounds in your head.
You've got to start by listening a lot, you know. And funnily enough, the tenor is different from the alto is different from the soprano, and so on and so on. So playing the saxophone is only a start. So it depends. Developing the sound is concerned, I think you have to work the individual instrument.
Totally.
So you do the same with alto. You listen to a bunch of alto players that you like, copy, you know, whether it's Paul Desmond, whether it's... Gerald Albright, David Sanborn.
Yes.
And you go from there, you know, and same with soprano.
I totally agree. Different. And they are very different.
And the soprano, they're very different instruments. And the soprano, here again, I didn't like that bright Kenny G type sound. I preferred the more mellow. Hence, I use a curved neck on my soprano. Yes. The straight neck gives you a brighter sound. So if you're trying to get away from that, you definitely have to use the curved neck.
And that's a really good...
And even the curved soprano.
Yes, that's a good example there of you matching your equipment to the sound in your head. Like, because I notice you play...
Yes.
Do you play metal mouthpiece on the soprano or not?
Yes, I use all Yonagisawa mouthpieces number 9... For all my horns, right up to the baritone. I know it's a lot of work, but
that's only
number nine on a baritone. It's just, you almost need to carry a pump, an air pump.
I want to talk about those.
Only because they have the consistency as a doubler.
Yes, yeah.
Because once you go from horn to horn to horn, and if you have big differences in mouthpieces, that's a lot of work.
Yeah, yeah.
A lot of readjustment all the time.
Yeah,
So that's the reason I chose all the similar
mouthpieces
yep. and reeds. I use the plastic Ricoh yes. plastic yes. cover reeds. I have been for a yes. long time, but I'm trying out the Berry plastic, which you introduced
for
me
my
to.
Listeners. For my listeners, I've almost got Andrew hooked on the Berry reeds. Yeah. So and are your saxophones all Yanagisawa? Are they all? Are you playing?
All except for the baritone. The baritone is okay. the Jupiter, but it's a silver-plated. It's a beautiful instrument, yes. actually. Gives me a big, yes. rich sound. It's just with silver-plated, it's very
yeah.
heavy.
Oh. Yeah, yeah. Well that's know. Right. I love playing the baritone, but you know, after yeah. 10 minutes, I'm wanting to sit down and have a rest. Yep.
And also, as a doubler, the practice routine is really yes. important. So, for example, I would line up all the instruments and do an hour on each yes. instrument with the same technical difficulty
Great.
Of music.
Wow, that's dedication, but it shows through in your playing. Yeah, you know. I want to go back to. I just want
Thank
to go
you.
Back to Silk for a moment and a segue yes. into another song of yours. Not only is the sound personalized and gorgeous, but what I love is. You are very select with the notes you play. It's not a matter of just spraying yes. out 1,000 notes, like as you would know, the typical saxophone player's ball is. How many notes can we play in 30 seconds and how high and how
yes,
low?
Yes, that's right.
But you are one of the few players that actually is all about, to my ears, telling a story,
yes.
having a conversation.
Yes,
with
it has
audience.
To be.
Yeah, oh, well, mate, it's yes. a rare, it's a dying art, and you should be congratulated for that. So much so, I want to play now, I want to play a short extract from a video clip of you playing tenor sax on the Eric Clapton hit, Change the World. This is
yes.
this is a fantastic yes. clip. It looks like on a TV set, you're out front of the band. The tenor sax is
That was
right
recorded at Channel 9.
Ah, so yeah, a very good band, yeah.
I think at the Carrie Ann morning show or something.
Okay.
It was done live.
You can tell it's live, and we'll play that clip in a moment. But what I'd just like our viewers to have a listen to is, again, this is a song where a lesser musician would go ape on the tenor sax and sort of try and play to a saxophone audience. But again, just like in Silk, you do yes. this beautifully. In fact, it reminded me, one of my early heroes was Boots Randolph and all of those Monument records where...
Oh, yes, I like
you know,
Boots.
He played Dolly Parton's 9 to 5 or something, and Boots had a lovely balance between giving it one on the saxophone. So for all of our saxophone, there'd always be something where you'd sit and say, wow, Boots can play. But the general audience... got to hear the song.
Yes.
So let's just take a listen now to Change the World, a look and a listen to Change the World featuring Andrew Oh on the tenor sax out front of a great band. Okay, Andrew, that's fantastic. I love the backing singers and the musicianship across that whole band is fantastic. I also like, and obviously you were quite a younger man at that time, I liked how you got into the groove and sort of, you know, had your own sort of little dance steps and grooves there. And I want to ask you this because the difference between being a performer versus a player. Yes. Like some people, if Wynton Marsalis comes out on the concert stage, don't expect Wynton to be in a monkey suit and doing all the dance steps with the trumpet. He will literally just stand there and play. But another player who might be a very good player, is more into the a little bit of choreography. Can you tell me in your career, because you've done an enormous amount of performing, how do you find that balance between the musician, the player, versus the entertainer?
A lot of saxophone players, for example, will be limited from movement because they're standing in front of a microphone.
Yes.
So therefore, if you've got a mic on a mic stand, you're there, you're glued to it, because if you move away from it, it's going to change your sound.
Yes.
Therefore, very early in the piece, I always believe in on a clip-on mic for the sax.
Yep.
First of all, the sound is always consistent.
Yes.
You're not going to move away from the mic or closer or, you know what I mean?
Yes,
The position
absolutely.
Of the mic is always at the bell.
Yes.
And therefore, and that alone allows the player to move freely, but not choreograph.
Yes.
Just to move with their own feeling and natural, movement.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's not a put-on. But I always believe that in performance, a performer should be a little bit more animated than just standing there, real stiff. Even if that's just a slight movement of the head or the shoulder, that's enough to convey that experience of performance.
I agree, and I think for our...
It doesn't have to be, over the top.
And
it has to be natural.
And I think Change the World there is a really good example where I think the viewer feels that everyone in that band, and particularly you in the spotlight, are really into that song. But it's not a put on. Hello, let's do the Rockets at Rockefeller.
It wasn't choreographed.
No. I want to move on now. I want to move on now to this album. This album here, your Andrew O album,
which was
recorded, I think, in 1997. Now I understand just from your website that. That album, was that fully recorded in Nashville? Where was it recorded?
It was fully recorded in Nashville at the home of a guitar player called Danny Gioza.
Okay.
Who is a phenomenal guitar player himself.
Yes.
But at the time, he was also the studio manager for George Benson. So he had a very good experience.
Do you reckon?
With recordings, right?
Yeah, wow.
And in the mid-90s, there was already a split to digital. And the question that was given to me was, do you want to record the digital way or the analog? And in the early days of digital, everything was very brittle.
Yes.
Especially the horn.
Yes.
It wasn't warm. Everything that is recorded feels like it can break like glass.
Yes, I agree.
So I chose the analog route.
Okay.
Only because it gave me the warmer sound, but not only on the horn, but also on the drums.
Yes.
On everything.
Yes.
So we recorded analog. And if you notice, there's also about two or three songs that I had backing vocals on.
Yes. Yes.
So the funny thing was that I requested for three girl backing vocalist.
Yep.
And then just about a week before going to Nashville, I thought, oh my God, I said, it's Nashville. I hope they didn't get me three country singers.
Yodelers.
Backing vocalists.
You didn't want a yodeler. Yodeler.
Oh, you know, a lot of backing vocals. They're used to singing with Dolly Parton and all the country people,
yes,
right?
Yes.
So I said, look, go to the church, go to the gospel church and get me three black gospel singers for these songs.
Yes.
Because they have to be soulful.
Yeah.
So that's what they did.
Well, and that is...
So I saved my bacon a week before a recording.
Perfect segue into the next track that I want to play, which is called Turn Up the Heat. And one of my comments here is, you know, you've got the backing vocalist. And I love, you know, when you think about it, the era of the instrumentalist being the focused... Was sort of back in the 40s and the 50s, you know, Harry James and Benny Goodman and all of they were the stars, Artie Shaw. What I love about your production is you genuinely put your instrument right out there in the front. You unashamedly put it there, but also support it, like those early Boots Randolph records, with the same thing that if Elvis were singing, they would have the backing singers and they would have the whatever. I really think, I congratulate you on that, because it's so great to hear the instrumentalists have the same level of respect in production that a singer would have.
Yes.
So let's have a listen to Turn Up the Heat featuring, I think you're on tenor on this one again, Andrew, still on Turn Up the Heat, I think?
Yes, that's right.
Yep. Okay.
Yep.
Let's have a listen to that. Okay, folks, so what a fantastic feel and a sound there from Andrew, again on the tenor sax. Let's talk about your alto sax playing. Now, from that same album, there's a number of tracks, but I'm going to play Got Me Real Good, which is a great alto feature.
Yes.
And a minute ago, you hit on two really important things, that you can't apply a tenor saxophone sound in your mind to the alto sax and really be convincing. You have to, and you name some players. I mean, if you had to pick, say, three or four influences for you when you were growing up, who's some of the key alto influences for you?
Okay, there were people like, they're more soul players, whether it's Girl Washington, Hank Crawford, those were the earlier players.
Yep.
Lou Donaldson.
Yes.
And I find David Sanborn had a very thin sound, especially in the earlier days. I wasn't keen on so much on his sound, but I liked his playing, but not so much his sound. But I also listened to players like, Paul Desmond and some of the bebop players. And I also got into players like Ornette Coleman, who's a little bit more out there. But, so alto is a tough one because it's hard to create an identity unlike the tenor. because alto is a particular tone in itself.
Yes, and I just want to pass a couple of comments there. I read an interview with David Sanborn probably 10 years ago, and he said he hated the sound that the producers got on his alto on all of those records. There's an album by David Sanborn called Pearls, P-E-A-R-L-S.
I have that.
And it's almost like, hello,
it's
there's...
It's beautiful.
It's beautiful. And I think what David's saying is he had no control over the massive compression and everything on his alto. And on that album, Pearls, he finally got to play Smoke Gets in Your Eyes and all the standards with a beautiful sound on the alto. So sometimes
that's
it's...
Right. And he probably had a hand in the mix.
Yes. You know, and it's interesting, isn't it, how... As an instrumentalist, or I guess as a singer too, you're at the mercy of the producer, you know, the engineer and the producer. And sometimes
what I hear in your recordings,
you've taken the time to somehow or other barge your way into the mixing desk and have your comment.
That can actually make or break the recording or the sound.
I agree.
Because... it has to be tailored to what the listener is hearing in the head and not what the producer thinks it should be.
I agree.
You know, it should always be the player's decision on the final sound.
So let's have a listen to a great sound on alto here from the Andrew O album, Got Me Real Good. Okay, Andrew, I want to take you right back to the beginning, back to your Singapore days. What was your first interest? When were you first interested in music? Not necessarily the saxophone. They may be one and the same event. But what's your recollection of, as a child, of first being really caught by the bug of music?
At 11, when I was 11 years old, I wanted to play music. And I told my father, I said, I want to play the drums.
Okay.
That's my choice. I wanted to play the drums. And he says, no drumming in this house.
It was before the electric drums, the little drum bass.
Yeah, that's right. But he was also a little bit of a jazz buff. Like, I mean, he enjoyed jazz. So he was listening to Louis Armstrong, Jerry Mulligan, you know, the Dutch swing college band, all that stuff.
Yes.
So anyway, he bought me an alto, and my first alto was a Selma Mark V.
Wow.
It was a very nice alto. I don't know where he got it from, but anyway, he got it for me. But I couldn't find a teacher.
Yep.
You know, in those days, trying to find a saxophone teacher that kind of lives close by, it's very, very hard. There's only a handful, you know. So we found a teacher, but he was a trumpet teacher. He played the trumpet. But nonetheless, you know, he could teach me how to read, you know, how to finger. And I joined the school band. So, and from there, I played in the school band. It was a marching band. One of those military, we played all the marching music. And then I was playing alto for a while, and then they bought a tenor, the school bought the tenor and said, we want you to play the tenor. I can't remember what the make was, SMH yeah. or something. But anyway, I tried the tenor. I said, wow. I said, that's it. That's what yeah. I like to play, wow. you know. I really like the deeper sound of yes. the tenor. So when I left school, I was already playing. But actually, before I left school, I joined a band. And at the age of 14, we got our first okay. gig. But the first gig was to back a striptease act in one of the bars in God. Singapore.
How did right? Dad feel about that?
So my mom said, where are you going to play yeah. tonight? Where's your yeah. gig? And I said, I don't know, Mom. Yeah. It's just at some club in the city.
Oh, my God.
So I had to learn Night Train
yeah, great song.
To back yeah. the act.
Yeah, on tenor. Yeah, yeah.
So
yeah.
that was my first gig. Yeah, yeah, on the tenor.
Wow.
Playing Night Train for a stripper.
Oh, wow. Isn't that at 14? At 14, were you?
At 14, yeah. yeah.
And did you...
And we had to kind of bluff our age yeah, and all yeah, that yeah, stuff yeah. to get in. Yeah. We got through the back door.
So was that a paid yeah. paid gig? Did you get... 20 cents or a dollar
it
or something?
It was a paid gig. Oh, it yeah. wasn't much, you no, know. But I think yeah. the band leader kept most of it.
Yeah.
It was just the excitement of playing a gig.
You should put that on your web.
And we were so worried about the music, we didn't even watch the stripper.
So
we were just, better not yeah. screw this up. No, you know, no, better no. get it right.
So your Singapore, life in Singapore, did you do all your schooling in when did you move to Hong Kong?
Oh, so after finishing school and I joined a proper band because there was an agency or several agencies that were hiring bands to play in all the clubs. And we were playing like five different clubs each night.
Wow.
So we'd play an hour in one club.
Yeah.
They will drive us to the next club, do 1 hour, drive yeah. us to. And he's got five different bands that rotates.
Yeah.
Each
wow.
band plays an hour. So by the time we finish work, it'd be like 4 a.m.
Wow.
And then the band had a contract to go to Hong Kong.
Ah.
So I went with them there.
Yeah, okay.
And it was the Bayside Club in Kowloon. And I remembered... Right. So we played there for 3 months. And the agent rang us up and said, look, I'm back in Singapore. I've lost all your 3 months' pay at the Macau casino.
Oh, great.
So
yeah.
make your own way back to Singapore. Tough. And he left.
Well,
so we
yeah.
were stuck in Hong Kong with no money.
Yeah.
And the club that we played in burnt down. So we lost that gig. So we found another yeah. club to work in just to pay the boarding, rent. The
yeah.
guest house that we were at and to save some money for the air tickets to get home.
Yeah. Wow.
So we found a club on the Hong Kong island called Go Down. And
okay.
and we worked there for about a year, earned the money, pay back the
yeah.
boarding house
yeah.
and you know, and got a ticket home.
I think that whole whole discussion comes under the chapter Welcome to the Music Business.
That's right. Welcome to the music world.
God, yeah, wow.
I know.
So you left but you left school straight into professional music, or did you do anything else?
Yes,
straight into. Okay.
That's
yeah.
right. At the age of 16 or something, 17, and I
straight
went
to
straight.
It. Yep.
I finished school, and 3 months later, I was on the plane to Hong Kong.
Yeah. And I know.
And while I was at school, I was already playing in the clubs.
And we've got some, I know you've sent me some photos, and during this I'll put up some different photos of you in those early bands. There's a lovely photo of you there with a Selma where you've drilled a hole in the top and put one of the Barkersberry bugs or something in there, which shows how you've been interested in electronics right from the beginning. Yeah. Yeah.
Yes.
Unbelievable. Yeah.
Well, what happened was I went to check out the band at the radio station, radio TV station.
Yes.
And there was a very good sax player there by the name of Horace Wee at the time. And he had the Buckus Berry bug. And he was playing through the
octave divider,
multi-divider. And I went, oh, my God, what on earth is that? So I made inquiries. I went straight away to the music shop. And the guy said, yeah, you can buy this bug. You got to drill a hole into the neck, you know. And you can buy, there's several devices you can buy to split up, you know, make it like a horn section. And at the time, I was playing a lot of soul music that had a lot of horn section stuff. So I bought it right away and played all the horn section through the Buckus Berry. It was actually a very good setup, but I just didn't like the fact that you have to drill a hole
that's what I
into the horn.
It's brave on your Selma.
I mean, you have a clarinet now with a hole in it, don't you?
Well, and I remember saying to you, and I remember saying to you in an email, my first time I saw Don Burrows play, it was at a little, wasn't a gig, it was a thing at the Queensland Conservatorium, a workshop. Don turns up with his concert flute, his B-flat clarinet and his alto sax, proceeded to play on every one of the instruments like twice as good as anyone that you would hear in a full-time professional gig. But on his clarinet, he had this little bug, and Don being Don, played it through his octava where he had bass clarinet and whatever, and just for the hell of it, then ran it through a wah-wah pedal. And I'm thinking, like, this is the this is my first time of seeing a really professional clarinet.
Well, there
you go. And Don's just up it. He's just playing unbelievable, you know. I want to move forward just for a moment. I want to move forward to this album. This is your current album recorded.
That's my latest,
in 2021. Now, this, I've already done some marketing for you with my flute students here, because I think this is primarily a flute album, but it's so refreshing, so refreshing for an instrumental flute album to come out that isn't playing, you know, Moon River and the Girl from Ipanema. It's a beautiful choice. It's a beautiful choice of songs. And just for our viewers, Andrew casually sent me an email one night and said, oh, you might be interested in seeing my latest video. And I thought, oh, this would be good. I click on the video, and this has got to be, and again, I'm really honest here, this has got to be one of the best bit of content that I've seen ever. This is a fantastic linkage of world-class animation with world-class musicianship. Now, the song is off the album. It's a flute feature of the Eagles' I Can't Tell You Why. But before we talk more about it, I just want our audience to see and hear this amazing piece of content. Well, folks, I don't. If you are listening to this as an audio podcast, I strongly recommend that you go and look at the video version, if only for that piece of music. It's absolutely brilliant. When I first saw it, I was sitting here in my studio and I just watched and I thought, my God, this has got to be the Walt Disney Lifetime Achievement Animation Award. Andrew has paid an absolute fortune to the boys at Pixar and Disney, because this is brilliant. The animation tells a wonderful story, and the music, you would absolutely swear that the music was written for that animation or the other way around. But the reality is quite different, Andrew. How, in fact, did you create that production there?
Well, you know, as you know, on YouTube, when you push to play a track, you only get the cover of the album for 4 minutes.
Yes.
And I thought, how boring is that for the listener or the viewer?
Yes.
So I told my friend Dean here, and I said, we got to put some kind of, you know, either images or video. And I said, if I can find something, I'll send it to you.
Yes.
So I was going through YouTube for copyright-free video.
Yes.
And I stumbled upon that one. And I thought, what a great animation and what a great story that would actually, the length of it
fit. It's perfect.
The length of
it's
the
perfect.
Song.
That's
so we used it. it's copyright free. I think it was done, I can't remember the company. Anyway, we did credit the company
that did the
video.
Did. And I've just played the full length.
But I love the
mate,
video.
I think that is inspirational for people out there who, particularly I think the younger players who are trying to find a way to make a mark and get their music out there. It is so perfectly matched. I still just shake my head at how beautiful that track is. The music, and thanks to the Eagles for writing the song.
Eagles, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. But what a beautiful interpretation you also, and the musicians who play with you on this album.
I had a great bunch of musicians on the album.
Standing ovation.
Yeah, very, 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 very,
everyone on that album. And I think is amazing when you read who played on these various songs is that there's never that many musicians. You are getting a very good sound with a handful of very good players. You know,
That's right. That's right.
Okay.
I used the aerophone quite a bit, like for some string lines and muted trumpet, the accordion, the harmonica. So I couldn't afford to pay any extra players to. You see, it was a COVID project.
Okay, yep.
And the challenge of this album to myself was, can I actually do a flute album and do it well? Because as you know, how difficult the flute is.
Absolutely.
And to make it sound personal is even harder.
And just on that, I totally agree. Like you can grab a tenor saxophone, learn how to do the growl, squeak out a couple of notes and go to the local, you know, rock band, and you're almost a legend relatively quickly. The equivalent of that on the flute does not exist, I'm sorry. There is nowhere to hide on the flute, and you can pick a shamster on the flute within one note. And when I hear you play, the first time I heard you play, and in fact, I have heard your flute before, but this album, I think I said to you that, you know, you've got your own sound, but it's absolutely obvious to me that you have put in an enormous amount of effort on the flute. I mean, a serious amount. You convinced me after the first note. and as I said, there's one little moment in there, and I think it might be on one of the tracks that I'm going to play later on, where I just closed my eyes and it actually felt like Don Burrows had come back and played a bit. And to reincarnate Don for even two bars is something. And I know our international audience never had the chance to hear Don Burrows, but I had the opportunity, living here in Australia, I saw Don Burrows play live, I think, probably more than 30 times, maybe 40. And I always walked away just totally inspired, but almost shoulders down thinking, why am I going to pick up the flute? This is obscenely brilliant when he's playing. But it was just so inspiring. And Don was just so approachable and relaxed as a player. Look at me, aren't I good? And I see the same in you. So what I want to do, I want to go back to Hong Kong for a moment now. Because on your website and in emails you've sent me, you casually listed some of the players that you performed with in backing bands and what have you. And amongst them were the Bee Gees, Sammy Davis Jr., Roberta Flack. Now, back in the timeline when you were in Hong Kong, there wasn't too many bigger artists in the pop scene than the Bee Gees. So you were playing with absolute top of the cream touring artists. I just want to, tell us about those experiences.
In those days, we had a lot of visiting artists. And for example, the Bee Gees, they come as the four or five of them. Four of them in those days. And they say, we need, 12 strings. We need, a few trumpets. We need a few sax and all that. And I remember that gig. We played it at the Causeway Bay racing track.
Horse racing tracks. Yeah, yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
They closed the racing for one night.
Yep.
And we played at that big racing track. And we the orchestra, were sitting on stage. And they flew the Bee Gees in with a helicopter.
Okay.
So the Bee Gees landed in front of the stage.
Yeah, wow.
You know? Yeah. And they came out and they joined the orchestra on stage.
Yeah.
It was quite amazing.
Yeah.
At the time. But
was your role a reading role? All charts, and your role is just to read the notes, or was there a bit of solos as Just read the notes.
Yeah. There wasn't any solo or anything because, in those days with the disco and all that, they had a lot of horn lines.
Yes.
And
the
Saturday Night Fever and mid 70s. So
that's a good point there, I guess, advice for young players. Nowadays through the school system they largely only learn to read music, but as soon as they get out of school they forget how to read and they just go jamming. But I suppose is your advice to keep your reading chops up if you want to play some of those high profile gigs?
For a horn player it's absolutely essential,
reading.
I mean, I know most guitar players think they don't have to read music, but to get the better gigs, you have to read.
There's an expectation that you're a good reader. Yeah.
Yes.
So part of your practice, you said before, where you'd go through, you've got your routine, I imagine part of your daily practice is some challenging reading. Yeah.
It's always. Yeah. I'll open a book and say, okay, I need to do that page 100 times with all the various instruments.
And it shows in your playing.
Just go for it.
What about the Italian connection? What about the Italian job, you call it?
The Italian thing was quite funny.
Yeah.
We met an Italian agent in Hong Kong when I was working with the band there at the Hilton.
Yep.
And he came up to us and said, I'd like to record you guys, but I want you to play Italian songs.
Okay.
And during those days of the disco era...
Yep.
We recorded Volare,
the
song Volare,
that's right.
In Italian, but disco.
So
he took it back to Italy and he gave it to the radio station and it became a hit.
Wow, okay.
So the agent said, well, we have to fly you to Italy because your single has become a hit.
Great.
So we said, all right, we'll go to Italy. Yeah. So we went to Italy, and the first place we played was at the Colosseum in Verona that had 40,000-seater Colosseum.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And that was massive. And we kind of look at it and go, my God, there's 40,000 people up there.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So, and And so when I was there, I met another agent who was a friend of this other agent that brought us to Italy. And he said, look, I've got an artist. The sax player that plays the flute left. And the percussionist also left the band, all in the same week.
Wow, okay.
And he said, well, Andrew plays flute, sax, and percussion. Can we borrow him for a couple of weeks? Because we got nobody else to fill up the spot. So they asked me. I said, I'll do it. Mm. I said, I'm just sitting around the hotel room anyway. So I did the gig, and he said, oh, well, you play all these instruments. Would you like to join the orchestra? I said, well, I'm only here for a couple of weeks, you know. I have one suitcase. Yeah. I have a business back in Hong Kong, because at that time I was running, I own and run a music school and a recording studio in Hong Kong. Yeah. So I couldn't not just leave and stay in Italy.
No.
So I went back to Hong Kong, and he kept, you know, sending me telegram in those days. There's no emails. It's all telegrams. Right. Yeah. So after about 6 months of telegrams, I say, okay, I'll come back. I'll join your group. So that's what I did. I sold the business, and went back to Italy.
Wow.
And joined his band for 5 years.
And then you also did some teaching in Italy as well, didn't you? Yes.
So I was contracted to this singer called Fred Bongusto for 5 years, but he only did about 100 concerts a year. His concerts were huge, you know. But the downtime during winter months and so, I was teaching in an art school called Centro Teatro Attivo.
Wow, okay.
And they had drama, dance, and music. So I was offered the teaching gig at this school, and I said to the principal or the dean or whatever, I said, look, I don't speak Italian. I mean, how on earth am I going to teach, you know, in Italian? Oh, he says, leave it with me. I'll come back to you on that. So the following day, he went and bought a dictionary. He came back. He says, you will learn. You will learn Italian. So he handed me the dictionary.
Oh, no.
And I said, oh, okay, I'll learn.
Wow.
So every word that I wanted to explain to the student, I'll say, momento. So I look up the word, and ultimately I gathered enough words to form sentences, you know.
Yeah.
So in 5 years that I was teaching, I got better with my Italian.
That's amazing, isn't it? Like I can only imagine what the first day must have been like. The first
a lot of sign language.
And that's right.
But you know what? The fortunate thing is that a lot of the music abbreviations are all in Italian.
Yeah, true. Music's that universal language.
So I would say, okay, piano, or forte, you know, they understand me right
That's
away.
That's amazing. Look, I want to move now to Australia, and you've been here, I think, almost 20 years. I'm just going to put up a photo here. I'll let you explain this photo, mate, because if this is all probably your first gig, I believe, was it, in Australia? Tell us about the arrow shooting moment. Yes.
Oh.
I'll put up that photo now of Tonton tattoo.
Right.
And if you can explain to the audience the story.
Yeah. Well, when I first came to Australia, I didn't know anyone, and everybody says, ring Don Burrus and join the union.
Yeah.
So I rang Don Burrus, and Don said, who are you? And I told him, he says, why do you... sax players all call me from overseas when you come to Australia and hassle me for gigs.
Okay.
Right? So I said, I'm sorry,
Someone's
Don. I said, you know, somebody asked me to call you. I called you. So he was a bit annoyed.
Like
so anyway, I finished the conversation with him, and I registered with the union, and the union rang me up and said, look, there is on the... an audition for a movie. Would you be interested to go and audition for? I said, yeah, all right. So I went, and I was sitting in this room. There were about five other sax players in the room, and I had to see George.
Lucas, is it? Or no, George? No, no.
No, no, not yeah. George Lucas. Yeah. Anyway, the two directors yeah. for yeah. Mad Max, but I didn't, no. I didn't know what no. the movie was. And I didn't know who Mel no, Gibson was because I came from overseas. So anyway, they didn't tell me what the movie or who was in the movie. They just said, we need a sax player for the movie.
Well, it's a job.
He says, go for the audition.
Yeah, that's right.
So I went for the audition and I sat in front of these two directors and one of them say, can you make the saxophone talk? I said, no, not really.
It's not one of those instruments.
Said, it yeah, only that's plays right. yeah. music, it plays notes, you know. Okay, can you make the saxophone laugh?
Well.
So yeah, out of desperation, yeah. I played this chromatic thing from the top. I went,
yes.
And made it laugh. Oh, he said, oh, that's pretty good. So he says, I'm going to describe a scene to you now. And I want you to blow and create the mood as I describe the scene. So he was describing the scene in the bar, and I played some bar music. And then he says, okay, there's an argument starting there in the corner. So I got a little bit more furious. And he says, oh, there's a fight now, and they're punching up. So I went really crazy in the sax. Oh, he says, that's very good. We have your number. Good. We'll call you. And then I didn't hear from them for months.
Wow.
And then I got a letter, and they said, oh, you got the part in this movie. And it's called Mad Max. And I didn't even know what Mad Max was.
Major.
So it was a very strange experience.
Yeah. And what about the scene with Tina Turner, I think? Did you end up in Tina Turner's tent or something? Or?
Yeah, that's right. So they said, your job in the movie is be the music man, you know, for Auntie Entity or Entity something. Auntie Entity, that was her name.
Tina
Turner's name.
Yep.
So he said, all you have to do is to play some solo sax behind her.
Yep.
And we'll shoot the scene.
Yep.
No, before that, they sent me to an optician to make me look blind.
Yes. But didn't they also, didn't they ask you, could they fire an arrow through your sax? Is that something that they...
Oh, yeah. All right. So the next thing they said to me was, oh, we have to shoot an arrow into your sax. And it's, so you're not doing that.
not for you, Yanagis. For you professionals.
Said, you're not doing that.
No,
it
no,
says,
no.
All right, well, we'll give you $200, they say. Yeah. You go to the hawk shop and buy one for $200.
Yeah.
I say, yeah, I can do that. I said... There's still a problem, I said. What if the arrow misses?
Yeah.
And shoots me instead, right?
True.
Oh, he says, no, don't worry about that. We got it all set up. What they did was they cut a hole in the sax.
Oh, right? Okay.
And
okay.
they put foam in it.
Yes.
And there's a wire that runs out of the sax.
Ah.
And the wire goes into the tube of the arrow.
Yes, and it's pulled
So
in.
When they fire it, it just goes... It follows the wire and straight into the sack. And that's how they do all the spears and everything's got a wire in it.
Yeah.
So when they throw the spear, it would just hit somewhere accurately without killing anyone.
I mean, you must be thinking, like, hello, Australia. Here you are. Don's giving you the right royal talking
Don's
to.
Don's giving Don, me the flick.
Yeah, get out. Yeah, he's probably been getting 10 of those calls every day. Someone's, you just imagine.
That's right.
So then you're around.
And he was at, he was teaching at the con at the
at
time,
the con,
Don.
Yeah.
And he wasn't very happy getting a call, from a stranger at the con. Asking him for a gig.
For a gig. Yeah. So it's interesting, isn't it?
But, it was funny.
But life moved on and you ended up playing with some amazing artists in Australia. And I just looked on your website.
Yeah.
You know, Margaret Ehrlich, Marcia Hines, Daryl Braithwaite, Grace Knight, Anthony Warlow, Doug Parkinson, Christina New. For people in Australia, that's the top tier. entertainers.
Yes.
And in fact, we've got a clip, again, a live television clip of you playing the flute in support of Margaret Ehrlich with a big hit song she had called Escaping. Let's have a look at that now, and then we'll talk a little bit about what your role was in that song.
Goodbye. You'll see me escaping to a lamp awake in the nighttime. Well, there's a secret place where no one can hurt you, desert you, and no one hurts you. That's why I'm escaping.
So, Andrew, that's an interesting clip there, because the flute plays an integral role with the vocals, but it's what was your involvement in that? Did you have free rein with that flute riff, or how did that come together, that arrangement for what became a hit song for Margaret Ehrlich?
That song that was on the album had no flute.
Ah.
That line... was done on the keyboard, and that was it.
Ah.
So I had to come up with my role. Now I was thinking, what am I going to play in the song?
Yeah.
Because, okay, after doing those twice, that's it.
So I
just improvised, and I came up with a whole bunch of stuff that could fill the whole song.
Oh, it's fantastic,
And I also use a curve head flute on that track.
I see that. And
on that recording.
And for
that was an Armstrong 104.
Yeah, beginner's
curve
flute. That's right. So
you tell... Yeah, beginner's flute. It came out in, I think, 85 or 86.
Yeah, they were a good flute.
And I thought, I got to try that, because it looks interesting. So I tried it, and it brought the flute so much closer to me.
Yes.
And playing with a loud band.
Yes.
I could hear myself.
Yeah.
You know, flute is
so
all about
soft.
Intonation.
Yeah.
So soft. So that's why I used the curve flute at that period.
So did you do some touring with Margaret Ehrlich, or was that a sort of once off TV appearance?
No. I worked with Margaret for 3 years.
Yep.
Touring
around.
We went to London. We played at Ronnie Scott's and all that.
Yep.
And then when I left Margaret, I joined a theatre show, the Blues Brothers, and the lead guy was Russell Crowe.
Oh, okay. Well, another movie connection.
So he was the lead guy in that show. So I did that for 6 months. And after that, I joined Tommy Emmanuel for a couple of years.
Well,
so that also took us all around Australia.
Yeah, and look,
Tommy was good to work for.
I was just going to say,
Tommy was great.
Let's talk about Tommy Emmanuel there, because we've got a beautiful clip here of you on soprano sax this time. So we've heard your flute playing, your tenor playing, your alto playing. And like all of your instruments, you've got your own sound on the soprano. It's a beautiful melodic sound. I'm seldom jealous of any musician, but I'm jealous that you've worked with Tommy Emmanuel, because I think there's the great there's the great players, there's the amazing players, and then there's those few players who in the history of their instrument have sort of took it to the next level. And I think, quite frankly, I think Tommy is certainly from a guitar point of view, the greatest musical export Australia has ever had. So for you to have the chance to play with someone like that,
Tommy would have hit the guitar in his hand for at least 12 hours a day, every day.
Oh, very dedicated.
I went to visit him at 8 o'clock in the morning.
Yep.
And he came to the front door
with the guitar
in hand and looking really sleepy. And I said, gee, Tommy, I said, you're up early practicing.
Yeah.
And he says, no, Matt, I slept with the guitar. Well, I fell asleep.
Fell asleep
playing
the guitar.
So he woke up still with the guitar in his hand.
Yeah.
He was very dedicated.
Oh, and if you look at his website,
like
he's still
musician.
Probably the hardest working musician in the world. You look at his website, and pre-COVID, this guy's playing 300 plus gigs a year, just all around the world, just night after night after night. I saw Tommy most recently at the Sydney Opera House before the COVID thing. He was there with Jerry Douglas on dobro, and because I love guitar and dobro, I'm in heaven. But Tommy comes out and plays an entire arrangement of Somewhere Over the Rainbow on his own in cascading harmonics. Didn't even look like missing a note, and the entire opera house crowd is just like hello. This is beyond someone who's naturally gifted and practiced a bit.
Yes,
so let's have a listen to you. And have a look at you since we met on soprano sax with the great Tommy Emmanuel.
Yep.
Okay, Andrew, that's fantastic. Touring with people like Al Jarreau and John Denver, I don't think you could get two polar different musicians than John Denver and Al Jarreau. I can imagine winging my way through Life's Got whatever it is, one of John's songs, but winging your way through, High Crime, the album High Crime by Al Jarreau, that's a different venture. Can you just talk about that your role, for example, in John Denver's touring band? What were you doing there? Tell us a bit about that.
Well, it was 1995.
Right.
I had a call from John's manager.
Yep.
And I think he was in Colorado at that time.
Okay.
And the first thing he said to me was, do you play the recorder too? He knew I played the flute and the sax.
The recorder, okay.
He says, John has about three songs that he needs you to play the recorder.
Okay.
And when he said that, and I didn't play the recorder.
No, I don't
at the time.
And so zero interest
I
in
said,
it. But...
yeah, of course I played the recorder because I wanted the gig. So
you got the gig as the
he
recorder.
He says, all right, we'll hire you. You know who John Denver uses on his sax? There's an American sax player called Jim Horn.
Yes.
Legendary
player. Yes. Yes.
Jim Horn was John Denver's
sax player.
Horn player whenever he toured.
Okay.
But that particular year, John didn't bring his band. So I went out to the music shop and I bought the recorder right away and started learning. He's got any song
and he's got
some other Celtic stuff that I had to learn really fast on the recorder. So I did that. But John was a delight to it. He was a real gentleman.
So. Yeah.
Good, good, yep. good guy to yep. to work.
So, when you played with John, was that charts or all just by ear?
Oh, no, it was all charted.
Even John Denver. That's interesting. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. It's all charted, except for the solo, sections. Yep. They all have chord changes, but he's got a lot of lines.
Now, what about Al Jarreau, the Jerry Hay horns? Now, I imagine those charts would have been rather intricate at times.
Oh, yeah. It was.
Wow.
It was like different worlds.
And
completely.
And I think for our listeners, I mean, I've got an enormous amount of respect for you as a player, because I know what it would be like to play Life on the Farm, you know, but to play with Al Jarreau and those original charts, man, that's polar opposites. And for you to be invited into those different things, I think shows your reputation and through hard work. Like a minute ago, you said your advice to people was learn to read and learn to read pretty good. Well, I think when the charts are handed out on the Al Jarreau gig, you would be thanking your lucky stars of all that work you'd had done there.
That's it.
I just want to go a little bit now to education. We're sort of coming down the home straight here, but what's your thoughts and advice, I suppose, on people? You know, there seems to me to be, you know, self-directed learning where you get the information you need from whoever you want, and you build your knowledge from that. There seems to be sort of directed study, maybe studying, and I know you have spent years in different places studying with great players. And then there's the normal, I'm finished school, what have I got to do? Mum wants me to go to university. I'm not too sure what I'm going to do with that performance degree when I come out of it. You know, you've had such a varied life in music. What would you advise if you've got a kid? I know you teach a lot of students yourself. What's your advice to them when they roll out off the assembly line at grade 12? They're interested in music. They're not too sure which way to go about it. What's your advice there?
Well, you know, music is a very tough career path to choose. And if someone chooses music as the career path, they have to be totally, totally dedicated, disciplined, and get the right education, whether it's with a single teacher or multiple teachers or universities, organizations, music school, whatever. They have to keep up with the studies. Unfortunately, there's no shortcut in music. I never went to a music university as such, only because I was always a working musician. But I always had the opportunity to meet some other great musicians. You know, I would go in a recording session, and that's how I picked up the flute. I was playing second flute in the recording session to a flute player who was the principal flautist of the Hong Kong Philharmonic
Orchestra. So he or she had a nice sound, you know, is what you were sort of saying.
He was an amazing player. Yeah. So I just said to him, do you teach? Do you give lessons? He said, yep. So I studied with him for about five years.
Yes.
Private lessons. But unfortunately for him, he was a great basketball enthusiast. Oh. He plays basketball every day, every day. And I said, Danny, be careful. He says, no, I love basketball. So he plays his basketball every day. And one day he fell and broke three fingers, and that was it.
Wow.
No more music. He's now a photographer.
One finger. I suppose that's good advice to be careful with your hand, you know, how you make a living, you know.
Yeah. I mean, people like Tommy Emmanuel, don't ask him to go skiing or bike riding.
He will not. Definitely not.
His fingers are the first priority.
And so they should be. Just want to talk a little bit now about the Roland Aerophone, because there's those early photos of you as a kid interested in electronics. What I like about, I've got behind me there, I don't know whether you can see it, I've got the Akai version of the 5000, EWI 5000. I occasionally play it.
Yes.
I've always struggled a little bit, in my own words, with the mechanics of that acai. In fact, I think I told you in an email, I've actually had for 12 months ordered on order the Yamaha digital sax, which is supposedly a direct copy of the Yamaha soprano sax fingering. I don't know, you've got a bit of a smile. I hope you haven't played it and found out it isn't. But I'm waiting to get that because I just like something that I can, that the interface is more human, more humanized.
Well, if you use that particular horn as an interface to connect it to some other sound module, it's fine. But if you're relying on the inbuilt sound, forget about it.
On all of them.
Because there's only about 76 sounds on that instrument, 56 of which are saxophone sounds. It's for me, in an electronic instrument has to play other sounds well.
It's got to be
like the Roland.
So I think you've done a great job of humanizing the EWI on the Roland. In fact, I just want to let our listeners hear a little extract from "Dance with Me," which is again off your current album. And I think there's a lovely example here where you cross from improvising on the concert flute to a muted trumpet solo. I really love this. Let's have a listen to that now. A gorgeous sound on the flute, and what a realistic sound on the muted trumpet. I think that's a really good example of, as I say, you being able to humanize the electronic wind instrument. And congratulations on what you're doing with the Roland product there. We're recording this in November 2021, and it's fair to say Australia's had a pretty decent run through COVID, much better than most countries. But even us just trying to organize this podcast has proven that COVID has had an impact and it has an ongoing impact here in Australia.
Absolutely.
Now, aside from being a master musician, you're also a little bit of an inventor because I came across a really interesting video where you demonstrate a flute shield, a COVID flute shield. And the video we've got here features a wonderful little flute player. Is it Dana or who's the flute player there?
Jade is her name. She played
sit back and think, come back in 10 years' time and listen to that little lady play the flute. But we might just look at the video first and then you can explain it. Okay, Andrew, so what's going on there? There's the candle, there's the breath,
Well, last year when COVID hit and I was talking, I'm a woodwind consultant for Jupiter Instruments too. And they were very concerned about how people are not buying wind instruments because of COVID. And they wanted something to provide some kind of confidence to the general public that want to buy a clarinet or a flute or something. So I came up with the idea of making all these masks. So there's masks for virtually every wind instrument from tuba to clarinet. And that is just a cloth around the bell that helps to control the projection of aerosol distribution while you're playing. But the most difficult cheel to make was for the flute. So, and that's the one that they wanted most. They said, you know, of all the instruments, the flute actually projects the most aerosol because it's an external blowing instrument. So I was sitting down at home and I was drawing patterns and stuff, cutting out cardboards and things. So I came up with the cheel for the head joint and for the lower, the foot joint too.
It's in...
And it's very effective.
As the video showed.
In the video, you will see Jade demonstrating that cheel, which is very effective. It shows her blowing without the shield and with the shield.
It's a good video, and
and how much protection it gives.
And it's it's a good example, I suppose, of the creative mind that you've got. You know, one minute you're soloing on jazz flute and muted trumpet. The next minute you're cutting out cardboard shapes around the kitchen table. So it's you know, you've had a wonderful life in music, and I hope it goes on for another 100 years. But it's just we're all starting to feel a bit old.
I
just got a couple of questions to finish on. You've spent a lifetime as a successful professional musician. What is your definition of music? If someone said to you, well, you know, a little alien lands from Mars and says, what's music? I've never heard. What is music? What do you think you... And there's no right or wrong answer here, but what do you think music is, having spent your life playing it?
Well, music is just an expression of an individual's thoughts and to convey a message in a different way rather than words. But I think music is so powerful because there's no barrier. You can play music anywhere in the world and you can touch someone's heart anywhere in the world, right? So the key to playing music is not playing a million notes a second, but to say something with every note, every single note has to mean and to say something.
And congratulations.
It's not about playing a million
a
minute.
That's a wonderful sort of definition, and congratulations on your lifetime of doing just that. Because I'm a sax player, and there's nothing drives me more nuts than, you know, a version of let's do Amazing Grace. And I'm thinking, oh my, it's a bit like, and it's the same, unfortunately, whether you watch The Voice or Australia's Got Talent. It's all about the gymnastics.
Oh, right.
But could we please get the message out? And thinking of what you described in music, think back to that first day in Italy. You could actually communicate with all your students on your instruments, but you had the dictionary at you know, hello.
Yeah, that's right. That's right.
You already could communicate. That's the beauty of music. It bypasses. Okay, along the same lines, what's your thoughts on improvisation or creativity? Where does it come from? What is improvisation?
Well, improvisation is an expression of creating music with your own mind and your own creativity. And it's a subject that can be learned. You know, once upon a time, they say, oh, you're either born to improvise or you're born not to improvise or can't improvise. And I don't think that's right. I think improvisation, as you know, is a huge study of progressions and harmony and scales and melodic development, all that, you know. So it's part of an expression, though.
Yeah.
And that's really it. And it's not connected with jazz, really.
No.
I don't consider myself a jazz musician, but I improvise. You know, improvisation can be... Musical improvisation can be applied to any form of music.
I agree.
Whether it's pop, rock, blues,
it's whatever. All about you're a creative musician. I don't know.
You're just creating musical lines, you know, from your brain.
And I've got to bring
and it's something that can be developed.
I've got to bring you back to your traumatic moment of talking to Don Burrows, because One of my memories of Don was at that same workshop where he was playing everything. It was at a Conservatorium of Music, and in those days there was no jazz at the Queensland Conservatorium of Music. So he did a little flute workshop, yes, and he asked for someone from the crowd, the students, to come up on stage with him. And this young lady came up, classical flute player, and probably the stiffest player I've ever heard in my life. So she would, Don would sort of just go, oh, let's just go, you know, bup, ba-da, ba-da-da, bup, you know what Don's like on the flute. And she's like,
yes.
And Don persisted. I just wanted to let you know. Don took about 20 minutes. He got her to actually do a convincing free improvisation on Mary Had a Little Lamb, just a couple of bars. But it was like a miracle. And I always thought, I don't think I would have had Don's patience. But he must have been like you, as if, no, this can be taught. In his mind, he was refusing to accept that even though this lady had spent her whole life on classical, he refused to accept that he couldn't get her to play a little bit of jazz. So I thought that was interesting. In episode one, my brother Mike Hayes, and I'm only paraphrasing him here because I'll get it wrong and I'll never hear the end of it if I get it wrong, but he said a wonderful quote. He said, if you're thinking about creating when you are creating, then you're not really creating at all. And at the time he said it, I'm trying to get my mind around it, but I think he's absolutely right. I think when you're creating, you're in another world, aren't you? You're in another space.
Yes.
It's not something you can sit there and think, oh, I'm going to play A flat next because it's in the Mixolydian scale. If you're genuinely creating, you know. We've collaborated. In fact, we haven't heard our collaboration yet, but we have collaborated together on a version of Sting's Fields of Gold. And I'm sure when we put it together, it is something we will all be proud of, because it's just something that I want to do with this podcast series is, as the host, I want to play with all my guests. I don't want it to be a once we were good at the good old days or the visit to the old people's home where the people once upon a time could play, including the host. So one of my things is let's create some new music together, and I'm really looking forward to presenting our version of Fields of Gold, sort of like a Sting arrangement. You're on...
It sounds wonderful, and your guitar
playing. Yeah, I'm playing slide dobro on this one. My brother's playing nylon string guitar, and you're playing flute and the Roland. Yeah, I'm really looking forward to that.
Yep.
Mate, the final question is, if you could go back in time to when you were that 14-year-old kid in Singapore and your dad got you the... You know, reluctantly, you didn't get your drum kit, but you got your saxophone. If you could take time travel back and give that little guy your best advice about, well, music and life. First of all, music. What would you say to yourself, having done everything you've done, if you could go back and give that little guy some advice?
Well, I think my advice would always be the same, which is always try to be original.
Right.
And not copying is great. You can always learn a lot from copying, but always try to cultivate your own voice.
Wonderful.
No matter what instrument you play.
Wonderful advice.
You know, and your own style.
Yeah.
You know.
Wonderful advice.
And in life, gee, I'm no expert on that.
Lived it though. From what you've learned, what do you think you'd say? Look, just in a nutshell, what would you tell you?
Have a good time playing. Always do the things that you enjoy most.
Yeah.
You know, don't let people tell you, oh, you should be a doctor or a lawyer or a dentist or whatever. You have to do what your heart tells you. I have so many students who have regretted not taking the musical path.
Yes.
Only because their parents at the time have discouraged them from doing so. I've had a few parents that literally rings me up and say, how dare you encourage little Johnny to be a musician?
How dare
and I
not?
Said, my job is to encourage.
Yes.
Yeah. I don't discourage. You know, whatever path they take is their own choosing.
Yeah, that's wonderful. Wonderful way to wrap up there, Andrew. And what an honor it's been, mate, to share a bit over an hour with you. It really has been an honour, and I hope we collaborate again in the future
real soon. Thank you for having me.
Okay.
Thank you.
Bye for now.
Bye-bye.
Well, what a genuine honour it was to share some time today in conversation with Andrew 𝗖𝗼𝘂𝗿𝘁𝗲𝘀𝘀. Please connect with Andrew via his website, andrew0music.com.au. A special thanks to my first guest, Mike Hayes, who returned in this episode to provide some wonderful melodic nylon string acoustic guitar solos in Sting's beautiful Fields of Gold. I look forward to presenting further conversations with some of the world's very best musicians in the future as the Music Mind podcast unlocks the key to successful creative lives. Bye for now.